that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. Grace that taught my heart to feel, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear. The hour I first believed. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I was blind, but now I see. And when we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. And I was blind, but now I see. That saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. And I was blind, but now I see. I was blind, but now
On behalf of the Jarrett family, I want to welcome you. I'm Ken Dye. My wife, Jane, is right down here on the front. We've known the Jarretts for about 36 years. And so when I think of the Jarretts, I just think of we're part of their family. And they've asked me to say a few things. Jerry and I were really, really, really good friends. And for a long time, I thought I was probably his only good friend. And then I found out most of us in here felt the same way. And I'll have a few other things to say about him in a few minutes. If you'll notice on the back of your program, there's a song, Crossing the Bar. Jerry liked this song. And in the third line of the first verse, it says, "And may there be no moaning of the bar." And on the third line of the second verse, it says, "And may there be no sadness of farewell." So Jerry would like for this to be a celebration. This is the urn where his ashes will be. I'm disappointed. I thought there would be red lights flashing. Streamers, there still may be, red tennis shoes underneath, et cetera, et cetera. That was the Jerry we knew. We're going to hear from Dave Brown and Tom Neville, who are family friends. And then after another song after that, we'll hear from Jason and Jennifer and Jeff.
I'm Dave Brown, and I've known Jerry for 50 years. I worked with him, worked for him every Saturday morning for 20 of those years. And I was most impressed by his preparation. When Jerry decided to split from Nick Gulas and run Memphis as his own territory, he'd been doing all the work for years anyway. So anyway, he got his own territory set up, but he knew he'd have to have several things. One, he had to have stars. Well, he started talking to the boys, we called them, the guys, the wrestlers, but he signed on as a partner, our big star, Jerry the King Lawler. That was a very smart move because Jerry Lawler, of course, was very well known all over the area. He also realized he had to have a television station. And he had to have a building to run the Monday night show. Well, the Coliseum was taken by Nick Gulas under contract. So he went down to Cook Convention Center downtown and signed a deal there. Wrestling had been there before it moved to the Coliseum. So that had the King, it had the building, and now he needed a television station because it could not have been successful without a television station. We had been on Channel 13, the ABC station in town, but our program director, Lance Russell, my partner for many, many years, went to his bosses and said, "We've got to go with Jerry Jarrett because he's going to have all the stars." Well, the New York attorneys got wind of this, and they said, "Absolutely not, because the Gulas promotion will sue us and we'll collect millions. Just cancel the show." Well, now we got to come up with a television station. So they went to the CBS station. They didn't have any time for them. Went to the NBC station, which is a legacy station, the first television station in Tennessee. And they were very interested because their news ratings had been sagging a little bit, and they knew the tremendous ratings power of the wrestling show and how they could use that to promote their newscast and improve ratings throughout. So Jerry Jarrett and Jerry Lawler said, "Well, Lance Russell is going to leave Channel 13. He is going to come to work for us, for the wrestling company. They said, and we can get Dave Brown over here to do weather for you. Well, that's first I'd ever heard of that. But it did work out, and thank goodness it worked out the way it did, because we had the best television station in town, and the show went on to huge, huge success. At one point during the 1980s, 8 out of every 10 television sets that were turned on in the whole Memphis market were watching our Saturday morning wrestling show. That's an unheard of number, period. That's how strong that television show was. And one big reason for that, one huge reason for that, is Jerry Jarrett. Jerry amazed me at the meticulous preparation he would do. We would have a meeting an hour before we went on the air every Saturday morning, and Jerry would go over the show, and he would go over it bit by bit. When Lance and I went out there, we knew exactly what our job was, and it was very, very easy. We just had to sell what we had just been told by Jerry back in the meeting. He was very, very meticulous. Before I go any further, I mentioned Jerry Lawler. Jerry would very much have liked to be here today. He, as you may know, has had some health issues here the last few weeks, and he can't travel for another couple of weeks, so he couldn't be here. But he asked me if I would read his statement. So if I may, I'll do that now. Jerry Jarrett, where do I even begin? A lifetime of memories with not only my longtime business partner, but my friend. Our friendship goes all the way back to 1970, when I first got started in the business. We shared our love for wrestling and carried Memphis Wrestling from 1977 through 1997 together. Jerry Jarrett put Memphis on the map and brought so many well-known superstars through our territory. The Rock, The Ultimate Warrior, Stone Cold Steve Austin, The Undertaker, Sting, and so many more. Jerry brought entertainment to the wrestling world, and without him, there would never have been two of my most memorable moments in my personal wrestling career. One, my title as the AWA World Champion, and secondly, my rivalry with Andy Kaufman, which is still talked about to this day and will be forever talked about, all thanks to Jerry. He was not only influential to me, but to the entire wrestling world as one of the best wrestling promoters around, and I am truly thankful for the many memories that we shared. My condolences and love to Deborah and the entire Jarrett family. I wish I could be there with you all today. Rest easy, my friend, Jerry Lawler. Other people that came through Memphis at the time included Hulk Hogan. Some of these Jerry mentioned: Undertaker, Sting, Ultimate Warrior, Honky Tonk Man, Plowboy Frazier, became known as Uncle Elmer, Superstar Bill Dundee, Downtown Bruno, became Harvey Whippleman in the WWE, Jeff Jarrett, of course, Rocky Johnson, and others. Stone Cold Steve Austin used to drive up from the Friday night show and spend the night sleeping in his car in our television station parking lot so he didn't have to pay money for a motel and he could keep the payoff. The Rock, Rocky Johnson's son, came through, and I saw him a couple of months ago, and he is forever grateful to Jerry and to Memphis and the Memphis television station, all of that together, for getting his career underway. He was just a kid. He was a good one. He was fresh out of college. He had been a football player in college. Wanted to get in the wrestling business like his dad, and he did. Well, he needed experience before he could go to the big time, the WWF. So they brought him to Memphis to do that. And he did become very good very quickly, and it wasn't long till they called him up to the WWE. As a matter of fact, they called him up so quickly, Jerry Jarrett And Jerry Lawler had to scramble to get him out of town because they had just made him the champion. Well, we couldn't let him go to New York and still be our champion because we knew he wasn't going to be able to come back and wrestle here. So what they did, they concocted this thing. It was a championship match on television with a loser leave town. Well, naturally, Jerry Lawler won and The Rock left town. He went to New York, has become the biggest box office star anywhere in the world. And at estimates, he's worth $10 billion. And still one of the nicest, nicest guys you will ever run into. And again, he told me how grateful he was to Memphis and to Jerry Jarrett. Jerry revolutionized the wrestling business. There is no doubt about it. WWE likely would not have been so successful without some of Jerry's innovations that he brought along the way. He understood the audience. He knew what to give them, and he knew what to hold back so that they would come back next week for more. I got a call from him, I don't know, a few years ago. Pandemic, I kind of lost track of time. But anyway, it was before that. But he called and he said, "Dave, I'm thinking about getting back into the wrestling business. My wife thinks I'm crazy. What do you think?" I said, "I think your wife's probably right. They usually are, you know." Well, we talked for a few minutes and he expressed that he needed me for television if he decided to do it. Well, fortunately for all of us, especially for Jerry and Deborah, it didn't come to pass. But he didn't need it. His legend will live for a long, long, long time. And I am proud to say that I was affiliated with the Jarrett promotion from its beginning until the time he sold it out. Not only that, I'm proud to call Jerry Jarrett my friend.
My name is Tom Neville, and my challenge here today is as a reformed lawyer to wind this thing up and not spend too much time. But I want to thank the Jarrett family for giving me this honor. It's a great opportunity to pay tribute to a man I loved. They've asked me to read one of Jerry's favorite poems, really an excerpt from it, The Man in the Arena. "It's not the critic who counts, not the one who points out how the strong man stumbled or how the doer of deeds might have done them better. The credit belongs to the man who is actually in the arena, whose face is marred with sweat and dust and blood, who strives valiantly, who errs and comes short again and again, who knows the great enthusiasms, the great devotions, and spends himself in a worthy cause, who, if he wins, knows the triumph of high achievement, and who, if he fails, at least falls while daring greatly, so that his place shall never be with those cold and timid souls who know neither victory nor defeat." Jerry lived that. Jerry was not only a great friend, but a mentor in my life. And the way he used to encapsulate that is he told me, he said, "Tom, always shoot for the highest limb in the tree." I'm sure some of you have heard that, heard him say that over the years. He says, because you'll get higher if you shoot for the highest limb in the tree than you will otherwise. We all know Jerry's unbelievable public achievements. Marine, huh? My wife's over there, and she told me, she said, "Tom, if you get emotional, I'll say Marine." I said, "Honey, I was in the Army. I wasn't Marine." She said, "We'll let this cultural appropriation pass, and just remember, a Marine, you know, is a real man, not somebody who was in the Army." So, anyhow. It was a week ago today, early in the morning, and I got a call from Deborah. And as soon as I saw it, I knew it probably wouldn't be good. The EMTs were there, and they were trying to revive Jerry. course, it was Valentine's Day. And when I got together with Deborah later that day, she told me that as Jerry was preparing to go to his next treatment, she'd gone up and asked him to be her Valentine. That is just one of the sweetest, most touching stories. But, you know, it tells a lot. It tells that after 50 years of being together, they kept their relationship and their love fresh. And I want to tell you, that was not by accident. Jerry was very intentional about that. A couple years ago, my son got married, and Jerry went up to him a week or two before getting married. He said, "Chris, you didn't ask for this, but I'm going to give you this advice anyhow. Never stop courting your wife. Never stop courting your wife." And Jerry lived that. He was so proud that he had managed to capture the heart of that Hendersonville beauty queen. He told me that over and over again. You know, the Bible uses the word heart over 1,000 times. The pastor at the church we go to gave a sermon on it once and said it was the most used word in the Bible. I tried to verify that. I Googleized it last night. I do know that it's used over 1,000 times. And of course, we're not talking about the physical heart. What God is interested in is your heart. That voice we all listen to. You know, we've all said through the years, "Oh, that person had a really good heart." Well, I want to tell you, Jerry Jarrett had a great heart. One important measure of a person is how you treat people who can't do anything for you. And what you do when you think nobody's looking. Tell you a couple stories. I was blessed to be in a position to have a front row seat to some of what Jerry did. Y'all may know that he owns some healthcare clinics, Right Care. So he called me up, golly, several years ago, and we started riding around Middle Tennessee from clinic to clinic. And Jerry and I one day went down to Shelbyville where we had one of our clinics, and we walked in. We were going to have a staff meeting. One of the young ladies that worked for us had a flat tire, and her husband had just been laid off from Tyson. And of course, we changed the tire, but it was one of those skinny little spares that you, looks like you can't drive more than 5 miles with it. So we started a staff meeting, and I looked around, and Jerry wasn't there. Well, we finished our workday down there, and we're driving back, and Jerry never said a word to me about anything relating to that young lady, her car, whatever. But I found out from that young lady the next day that Jerry not only bought a new tire for her, he bought her 4 new tires. And I'm sure we can all think about examples in our own lives where we saw that with Jerry. That was just part of his pattern of life. That's what he did. I was a beneficiary of that. 30 years ago, I was going through a rough patch. And Jerry and I had children at Brentwood Academy. And we used to go out late afternoon. We'd watch the football team practice. Jerry came up to me, 1992. Prior to that time, we'd known each other casually, shaking each other's hands. And he came up, and what he told me that day is going to remain between Jerry and me. But I will tell you, he was as good a friend as any man ever had. And I know, just like we heard earlier, I'm sure he made each and every one of you at one time or another feel just that special. That's who he was. So, what I'd like us all to focus on today as we leave here is to think about the non-public Jerry, the Jerry with the big heart, the Jerry who made everybody feel special, the person who never forgot where he was from. Thank you.
Just as I am, without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to thee, O Lamb of God. I come just as I am, though tossed about with many a conflict, many a doubt, fightings and fears within.
You know, we got a saying in sobriety. The good news is you get your feelings back. The bad news is you get your feelings back. So I hope y'all can bear with me through this. like Ken said, I appreciate everybody coming. The well wishes that I've received have been overwhelming. And with Dad's passing, I guess as tradition would go, trying to think to put the service together. I think Deborah immediately thought of it. I thought of it. All of us kind of thought of it, that what am I going to say? The words that came to my mind is, how can I pass on his legacy? You know, my dad never had a father. He went off to the war, came back, but he didn't come home. And so we heard from Dave Brown, a good friend and a wrestling announcer in my dad's life. And Mike Tenay is another wrestling announcer in my dad's life. And Mike used to say that my dad was the most well-read individual that he's ever met. Dad always had a book, history, philosophy, autobiographical. Easy for me to say, just it's what he did. He read. And over the last week, I've kind of had time to reflect and really think through that. And I think in so many ways, that's how my dad learned, self-taught. He self-taught himself in so many things. And growing up, I can remember 17 years of age, sitting at a breakfast table and your dad reading the Martin Luther King speech. I have a dream. And he would start crying. And I never really understood why he would get so emotional. But as the years roll by and I understand that he didn't have a model, he didn't have a dad that taught him. And so he modeled speeches and words of wisdom, and that's just how he fathered. And so today, I want to read two of the readings. I'll take a step back. That quote that Tom said from Teddy Roosevelt, the man in the arena. I don't know how many times I've heard that. It's in his wallet today. He carried it around. I encourage you guys to read that because it really is how to live life, not sitting on the sidelines, no matter what you do. And so me and Jason had a conversation and I said, hey, Jace, I'm going to read one. Why don't you read one? And he said, oh, hell no, I'm not doing that. He said, that's not for me. You go ahead and do that. You can get in front of a microphone. And I said, well, tell me about that, Jace. And he said, that man in the arena, it's framed in my son's wrestling room, my workout room, my training room. And Dad didn't know that. But Judson knows it now. This room knows it now about my dad's legacy and how he taught it carried on. And then this poem I'm about to read, if I make it through it, my dad knew it by heart and he would phrase things out and say different things. And it's so good and it's so powerful. And again, it's a part of his legacy. It's the poem, If, by Rudyard Kipling. If you can keep your head when all about you are losing theirs and blaming it on you, if you can trust yourself when all men doubt you, but make allowances for their doubting too, if you can wait and not be tired by waiting or being lied about, don't deal in lies, or being hated, don't give way to hating, and yet don't look too good nor talk too wise.
If you can dream and not make dreams your master, if you can think and not make thoughts your aim, if you can meet with triumph and disaster and treat those two imposters just the same, if you can bear to hear the truth you've spoken, twisted by knaves who to make a trap for fools, or watch the things you gave your life to broken and stoop and build them up with worn out tools. If you can make one heap of all your winnings and risk it on one turn of pitch and toss and lose and start again at your beginnings and never breathe a word about your loss. If you can force your heart and nerve and sinew to serve your turn long after they are gone and so hold on when there is nothing in you except the will which says to them, hold on. If you can talk with crowds and keep your virtue, or walk with kings nor lose the common touch, if neither foes nor loving friends can hurt you, if all men count with you but none too much, if you can feel the unforgiving minute, with 60 seconds worth of a distance run, yours is the earth and everything that's in it. And which is more, you'll be a man, my son. And then this next one, and I just learned from Jason as we were chatting, it's hanging in the bathroom of the workout room. It's the poem that I read that my father produced and had me read in my very first wrestling promo. But more importantly, I wouldn't be standing here today if my creator didn't want me to be standing here. 5.5 years ago, I had 2 feet in the grave and the rest of myself on the way. But only by the grace of God am I standing here. But this poem, from our earthly perspective, is the mentality that kept me going. I had no relationship with my wife. I had no relationship with my kids. My business was a disaster. I had friends, but they just tolerated me. But the words that I'm about to read, in so many ways, sustained me. And that gives me strength to know that my dad, Jarrett, will live on in me until I meet my creator. And I pray to God that these words live on in my kids and my nieces and nephews. Because my dad believed every word of this. And the name of the poem is Don't Quit. When things go wrong, as they sometimes will, when the road you're trudging seems all uphill, when the funds are low and the debts are high, and you want to smile, but you have to sigh, when care is pressing you down a bit, rest if you must, but don't you quit. Life is queer with its twists and turns, as every one of us sometimes learns, and many a failure turns about when he might have won had he stuck it out. Don't give up, though the pace seems slow. You might succeed with another blow. Often the struggler has given up when he might have captured the victor's cup. And he learned too late when the night slipped down how close he was to the golden crown. Success is failure turned inside out, the silver tint of clouds of doubt. And you never can tell how close you are. It may be near when it seems afar. And in 2018, when I was inducted into the Hall of Fame, these are the words that I said, because they ring so true not just in my life, but in my dad's life, over and over and over. And nieces and nephews and my kids, I pray to my Lord and Savior that this mentality and these last words are truly what you take away from here today, or part of what you take away here today. So stick to the fight when your heart is hit. It's when things seem worse that you must not quit.
Daddy brought me this this paper here, and he says, being the promoter that he was, he wanted me to keep this. And of course, I put it away and told him I didn't want to see it. It was years ago, and I didn't want to talk about this. So I had never looked at it until Wednesday morning. And he has in here something that he wanted shared with all of you. And it is a letter to us, to his children. I realize that in your hearts and minds that I might be larger than life on occasion, and that perhaps on other occasions I failed to rise to your expectations. In death, we all choose the former and forget the latter. In this celebration of my life, I hope you will remember that I was both. I hope you will know that I was both a brave man and a coward, a very smart man and a very dumb man, a very successful man, yet a man who failed often. I was at times the very best of you and also the worst of you. I hope you will realize that my greatest achievement in life is you. Each of you are part of my eternity. Listen to God and allow him to guide you, Dad.
I come to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever. I'd stay in the garden with him, though the night around me is falling, but he bids me go through the voice of woe. His voice to me is calling, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known.
There's a story in the Old Testament. If you're a church person, you've heard it preached on a good many times. Moses was wanting to go into the promised land. The children were with him, the children of Israel. And God said, I'd like for you to take one person from every tribe and send that group into the land to spy out the land. So they did. They came back in a few weeks. They said, oh, it's incredible. I remember a picture in one of my early Bible story books. Had two men and it had one stalk of grapes between them. It's just wonderful, they said. It's just amazing. There's big cities. And there's lots of people and rich soil. And there's water and the fertile ground, and it's just amazing. But the cities have big walls around them. The people are like giants. And so 10 of them said, we just don't think we should go in there. We'll never be able to make it. Even today, that's kind of the proportion of those who are optimistic and those who are not. 2 said, oh, I think we can do this. God's going to help us. One was Caleb. The other was Jarrett. Well, Joshua. Just the same kind of person. He just never thought he couldn't do something. I remember one time he said, Ken, I was out of money. I didn't know what I was going to do. And I was sitting in the house up on that big hill, and I was just sitting there frustrated. The doorbell rang, and I went to the door, and there was this man there, and he said, Jared, you own all this land around here? And Jared said, yes. He said, I'd like to buy some dirt from you. Jared said, Ken, I made thousands of dollars off that dirt. Jerry and I had a unique relationship. I've known him 36 years. I have yet to have a conversation about wrestling. I wanted to. You see, I grew up watching television in the, let's see, 60s, 50, in the 50s. And on Friday nights, we'd go to our friends, and there was Gorgeous George throwing out these gold bobby pins, and Lou Thesz, who was the champion of the world, who was incredible. And I wanted to talk to Jerry about all that. But when we got together, we talked about God and family and who knows what. Well, Jerry talked about God and family. I listened. We were really good friends. And my time initially started with him right here in Hendersonville. I was the minister for the church. I think I baptized you, Debbie, and Jason, and Jennifer. And then I did your weddings. One of the great things of ministry. And he gave me a nickname. He said, "You're the main event." I said, "Really?" He says, "Oh, yeah, you're the main event." On Saturday night before Sunday church, he would call me. The phone would always ring. "Is the main event on tomorrow?" I said, "Yes." He said, "I'll be there." As long as I was there, he was there. And then when my time ended there and I was out in Nashville somewhere, every once in a while I'd call him and I'd say, "Jerry, the main event's going to be on in the morning, such and such and such and such." He was there. He and Debbie were always there. He had great faith. He loved God and had such a unique relationship. He wasn't all that much on church, but he was all that much on God. He was reflective, he was intuitive, and he saw God in every one of you and in everything. Here in Hendersonville, one night we had a big men's meeting, and I had to get the speaker, so I asked Jerry to be our speaker. I held my breath because sometimes he could let certain things slip out, and I was just praying, not here at church, Jerry. But he got up and he said, "I want to tell you a story." He says, "I grew up going to church, and my mother taught me when I made money to give 10%. And he said, "I began to make a little money, and I started making $50 a week. And he says, I'd go to church, and I'd give $5. He says, that began to develop even better. I started making $100 a week. I gave the church $10. He said, the longer, I think he got into the wrestling business. He said, I was making $1,000 a week. He said, gave the church $100. And I'm just sitting there wondering, where is this going? He said, one year I made $1 million. And my accountant said, you can't give the church $100,000. And he said, I didn't. The next year I didn't make anything. I've never forgotten that story. I've never had anybody that open and that honest about money or giving or church or whatever. I want to talk to the family for just a minute. Debbie, you said yesterday, he gave me confidence and he made me feel good about myself. Well, he breathed into you three confidence and to never feel bad about yourself. That's the way he treated me. He made me feel like I was so good and I could do so much. And for all of us, that's the way he made us feel. It's no accident, Debbie, that you're here and he's gone. Jane and I, as we get older, we have realized if we continue to live, one of us will be alone. That's hard to think about. But you're here because you're strong. And you got three of the greatest kids in the world, incredible grandchildren, wonderful in-laws. And there was nobody you'd rather be with than him. You had so much fun. You had him for, 50 years? 51 years. And so I'm so thankful that you were his anchor. When he would say, "Ken, here's what I want to do with you. And I'd look to you, Debbie, to see, is this possible or should I just kind of ride along? You were his anchor. He would sometimes say, Deborah, please. And you had to be the strength. And you had to share him with everybody. There, you never knew who he was going to bring home and who was going to eat with you and who might take a trip with you. But you were so fortunate. You got to live with that rocket. Last night I was thinking, I was trying to go to sleep, and I thought, every morning you would wake up, Debbie, and wondering, where's the rocket going to take me today? Well, he had passion, and he had vision, and as the rock said, what a life. Well, we're really fortunate to have met someone who was so optimistic. The 10 spies said, no, we'd better not do it. You know, we might fail. Let's start a committee and study this thing. Let's not make decisions so quickly. And the Jerry Jarretts of the world said, come on, we can do this. Let's shoot for the highest limb. So we're all here celebrating his life. Now, it's really good that you and I are here to be reminded we too will be talked about one day, like Jerry. And we too will be remembered. There are some of you here very successful because Jerry saw something in you that you didn't see in yourself. In those instructions that he gave to Jennifer, he also said, mention John chapter 14. And I'll close with this. It's an incredible passage. It's Jesus talking in the New Testament. And he said, do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. When it comes down to it, it's our relationship with God. We too will pass. Don't be troubled. Trust in God. And in the last part of this chapter, Jesus says, peace, I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. And then here is the encouragement. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Do not be afraid. I am so grateful he loved me. In my mind, I will always be the main event for him. Let's pray. Father, you bring into our lives sunrises and sunsets and good times and COVID. You bring us struggles and happy times, and you bring people into our lives who make a difference. And then you wait to see if we will go into other people's lives to make a difference. I want to thank you for Jerry and what he meant to me. For that one single moment in time when he said, let's start a new church. We'll do it in the backyard. And we did. Thank you, God, for the reflectiveness in his life as he would spend time with you than he would spend time with us. I pray that you will put your angels all around Deborah and keep her strong and lift her up. Because he was so big, he will be missed. And I pray that you'll continue to bless these three incredible people and keep them strong. And touch Jeff and Jason and Jennifer. And already I know that his genes are in them. And I pray that he will be remembered and honored by the good things they do. We pray that our hearts will not be troubled, neither will they be afraid. In Jesus' name, amen.
Old man Wrigley lived in that white house down the street where I grew up. Mama used to send me over with things. We struck a friendship up. Spent a few long summers out on his old porch swing. Was in the war, went in the Navy, lost his wife, lost his baby. Broke down and asked him one time, how you keep from going crazy? He said, I'll see my wife and son in just a little while. I asked him what he meant. He looked at me and smiled, said, I raise my hands, bow my head, I'm finding more and more truth in the words written in red. They tell me that there's more to life than just what I can see. Oh, I believe. Years later, I was off at college, talking to Mom on the phone one night, getting all caught up on the gossip, the ins and outs of the small town life. She said, oh, by the way, son, old man Wrigley's died. Later on that night, I laid there thinking back. Thought about a couple long lost summers. I didn't know whether to cry or laugh. There was ever anybody deserved a ticket to the other side. It'd be that sweet old man. Look me in the eye, said I raise my hands, bow my head, finding more and more truth in the words written in red. They tell me that there's more to life than just what I could see. I can't quote the book, the chapter, or the verse. You can't tell me it all ends in a slow ride in a hearse. You know I'm more and more convinced, the longer that I live, yeah, this can't be, no, this can't be, no, this can't be all there is. Lord, I raise my hands, bow my head.
truth, the words written in red. They tell me that there's more to this than just what I can see. I believe. I believe. I believe. I believe. Whoa.